Can I invite you please to stand? May the grace and peace of God our Father, the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ, and their Holy Spirit be with us as we gather in prayer, reminding us of our shared faith and hope in the Lord's resurrection. We'll begin our Requiem Mass this morning singing together the hymn printed in the order of service. It's also number 966 in the hymn book 966. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Welcome to our celebration of Mass this morning, a Requiem Mass for the repose of the soul of Rebecca Boyle, Ruby, I think, as she was known to us all. And I welcome the members of the family, friends, extended family, members of this parish community, and particularly those who have helped care for Ruby in these last few years of her life. And I extend my own and those condolences also of the parish to the family, to Jerry in particular. Our Requiem Mass begins in a very particular place, and if you're not familiar with the Catholic funeral liturgy, it might be a place that surprises you, because that place is, as we celebrate the end of the Christian life on earth, the beginning of the Christian life on earth. So we begin with the signs, symbols and prayers that recall Ruby's baptism. Why do we do that? Well, you'll hear in the scripture readings this morning an echo of the reason. The reason is, St. Paul writes to the early Christian community, and we'll hear something of that. that going into the waters of baptism is like going into the tomb with Christ. So that just as he was raised to new life, we too come from the waters of baptism to live life anew and to know the promise of life eternal. So as we end the Christian life on earth, we recall its beginning and also the commitment that God made to Ruby as she made her commitment to him through her parents and godparents. And God, as we know, is always faithful to what he promises. So that's why we place on Ruby's coffin the white funeral pall, a reminder of the white garment in which the newly baptized are wrapped. They're asked to clothe themselves in Christ. Often it's people's attire we see before we recognize who it is. That's the purpose of a uniform. So we're asked as members of the body of Christ, as Christians, to show forth Christ in all that we say and do, to be clothed in Christ. And we give thanks that Ruby was that presence to others. It's why we light our Paschal candle. We light this candle when we celebrate the Lord's resurrection at Easter time. Church is in darkness. This candle is the only one that's lit. And we all take from this candle a light, and we proclaim Christ our light, the risen Lord Jesus, who guides, who encourages, who illuminates our lives. And we all share that light, but it doesn't get any dimmer, but rather the light of it fills the church, and we pray through Christians the earth. So we give thanks that the light of faith in the risen Lord Jesus was part of Ruby's life. Not only did she have it, also she shared it. And it didn't get any dimmer by the sharing, but rather illumined the lives of others. It's why also I'll place on Ruby's coffin the two principal hinges, two principal symbols of the Christian life. They are the book of the Gospels. The Gospel is for us, as we know, a guide, an encouragement, a rule of life, if you like. So as I do so, our prayer is that Ruby hear the words of the Lord. Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you since the foundation of the world. And secondly, the cross. To some, the cross is seen as a sign of defeat, of death, of the end. But we as Christians have a context for our suffering, and that is the suffering of Christ that led not to the end and to death, but to resurrection and to new life. That she who shared in the sufferings of Christ may also share his victory over death. And the symbols we associate, I think, most obviously with baptism are the waters of the font. So in baptism, Ruby shared in the death and resurrection of Christ. I sprinkle her remains now as we begin, and I'll do so at the end of Mass as a reminder that she was a sharer in the death and resurrection of Jesus throughout her life, and that gift come to fruition in the presence of God this day. My brothers and sisters, we believe that the ties of friendship and affection which knit us as one throughout life do not unravel in death. Confident that God always remembers the good we've done and forgives our sins, let's pray, asking God to gather Ruby to himself. Lord, in our grief we turn to you. Are you not the God of love, always ready to hear our prayers? So hear us as we pray for Ruby, whom you've called from this world. Lead her to your kingdom of light and of peace. Count her among the saints in glory. Our prayer we make through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Whenever we gather for the celebration of a Requiem Mass, we recall that we are all sinners. So we pray for forgiveness for Ruby, that she might readily ascend to the mansions of the saints. But we recognise our own frailty and failure, but we do so in the context of God's overwhelming love and forgiveness, so that we might celebrate worthily. We call to mind our sins, we ask God's pardon. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners, Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Lord God, whose nature is always to forgive and to show mercy, we pray for your servant Ruby, whom you've called to journey to you. Since she hoped and believed in you, grant that she may be led to our true homeland to delight in everlasting joy. We make our prayer through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Can invite you to sit, and we'll listen together to the Holy Scriptures, to the Word of God.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. With God on our side, who can be against us? Since God did not spare his own Son, but gave him up to benefit us all. So we may be certain after such a gift that he will not refuse anything he can give. Could anyone accuse those that God has chosen? When God acquits, could anyone condemn? Could Christ Jesus? No, he not only died for us, he rose from the dead, and there at God's right hand he stands and pleads for us. Nothing, therefore, can come between us and the love of Christ, even if we are troubled or worried, or being persecuted, or lacking food or clothes, or being threatened, or even attacked. These are the trials through which we triumph by the power of him who loved us. For I am certain of this, neither death nor life, no angel, no prince, nothing that exists, nothing still to come, not any power or height or depth, not any created thing can ever come between us and the love of God made visible in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The response to the psalm, the Lord is my light and my help.
The Lord is my light and my help.
The Lord is my light and my help, whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life, before whom shall I shrink?
The Lord is my light and my help.
There is one thing I ask of the Lord, for this I long, to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to savour the sweetness of the Lord, to behold his temple.
The Lord is my light and my help.
O Lord, hear my voice when I call, have mercy and answer. It is your face, O Lord, that I seek, hide not your face.
The Lord is my light and my help.
I am sure I shall see the Lord's goodness in the land of the living. Hope in him, hold firm and take heart. Hope in the Lord.
The Lord is my light and my help.
Please stand for the gospel.
Hallelujah.
be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Seeing the crowds, Jesus went up the hill, and there he sat down and was joined by his disciples. And then he began to speak, and this is what he taught them. How happy are the poor in spirit. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Happy the gentle. They shall have the earth for their heritage. Happy those who mourn. They shall be comforted. Happy those who hunger and thirst for what is right. They shall be satisfied. Happy the merciful. They shall have mercy shown them. Happy the pure in heart, they shall see God. Happy the peacemakers, they shall be called sons of God. Happy those persecuted in the cause of right, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Happy are you when people abuse you, persecute you, and speak all kinds of calumny against you on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great in heaven. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. I can invite you to sit for a moment.
Whenever I hear those words that St. Paul wrote to the early church in Rome, his letter to the Romans, that John proclaimed for us this morning, I'm always taken aback. I'm slightly in awe of the certainty of his faith, the solidity of it. And we know ourselves that faith is stronger sometimes in our lives than others. And important events can either rock our faith or can confirm our faith. And we all react in different ways at different times, depending on how well we feel within ourselves, how secure we are before God, in our relationships with each other and in our path of life. But Paul is absolutely certain, rock solid, and I envy it, I have to say, I envy it. And it's good to know this is not some sort of pious musing of some fool. This is someone whose faith has been severely tested in many different ways. He himself, as we know, famously had to undergo a real rethink of his life and how God revealed himself to his people, what God's covenant relationship with his people was like. He had to seriously reevaluate that with the insight he had on the road to Damascus. And he has, as we know, both from his own writing and from the Acts of the Apostles, been subjected to persecutions of various kinds in various places. He's been beaten and flogged, stoned, and run out of town, and left for dead on a number of occasions. And it becomes apparent to him as his life goes on that his sharing in the Christian life, that to which he's been called, involves not just trying to live as Christ taught, not just trying to say the things he said and do the things he did, but it becomes increasingly apparent to him that he will have said about him the things that were said about the Lord, and done to him the things that were done to the Lord too. And yet there he is, solid in his faith. Where does that come from? Well, it comes from the same place as we began, our solidity in the belief that God is faithful to his promises, that in baptism we share in the death and resurrection of Christ, and are promised a share life eternal. So that's, if you like, a given for the Christian life. But what is not a given are the choices that we make in how we live that vocation that we've received, and how we embrace new life and resurrection and the Lord's command in our day-to-day lives. And in that, I'm grateful to the family for sharing something of Ruby's life and their experience of her with me Many virtues are part of that, as some or all of you will know some or all of her story. She shares it with many of her generation in Linwood, growing up in Govan, enjoying the usual pursuits of dancing and the movies, all of course going through a variety of revolutionary phases in that life. Jerry, extraordinarily married for 65 years, a great tribute to fidelity, to stability, and I'm sure to tolerance, and to even temperedness, and how delighted she was, having been part of a large family herself, to be part of a large family, her own children, grandchildren, and latterly great grandchildren, bringing great joy to her life, and with Jerry pursuing simple pleasures, hill walking, holidays first in Scotland, and then while latterly maintaining that fitness and that joy in her own culture and surroundings, branching out to holidays in different parts of Europe, Malta being a particular favourite, Jerry tells me, and a place I know that many of us feel at home. Those are all powerful things, and I think maybe to recognise in the simplicity of life, a life well lived and generously lived, great virtue, to get to her age and to take delight in sitting, chatting over a cup of tea and I believe a Marks and Spencer's fondant cream, as long as they were pink, was a joy. And that kind of, to be able to take pleasure in simple things is a great virtue, and it seems to escape more and more of us more and more often. But what does that do? Where does it place us with each other and before God? Well, we talk about being baptized, sharing already in the life of the world to come, being the saints, being the blessed, as the gospel calls them. I wonder if there's a good perspective today on that. We have in the Beatitudes those enunciations of who is blessed, who is happy, who is saintly, very direct invitations to us. But it's good for us to recognise that those things are not proper to the saints in heaven. I think, I hope, I pray that heaven doesn't need peacemakers, doesn't need the merciful, doesn't need those who hunger and thirst for the presence of God. It doesn't need those who are persecuted in the cause of right. Those are virtues proper to the saints on earth, not proper to the saints in the world to come. So our call, our vocation, the way we live our baptism, the way we live our share in the resurrection, our blessedness, our saintliness, is not for the world to come. It's for the present world. And we know how much our world needs people with mercy, people who recognise a context for mourning, people who are merciful, people who recognise that their persecution in the cause of right is not the end of their virtue, but rather the opportunity for it, and that the integrity of heart that Ruby showed forth in her life, in her long marriage, in her stability, her faith, in her application to her work, and indeed the joy in her recreation, are all virtues proper to the saints, but proper to the saints on earth, and sure, a sign of the world to come. So maybe for us, it's to recognise that this turning point in your family's life is an opportunity for you to recognise the powerful example of virtue that Ruby modelled, what she said, what she did, how she lived her life, and how she loved her family. Those are powerful things. It's maybe only on reflection that we acknowledge them, that we recognise what's handed on to us, that we make those virtues our own, and that we in turn hand them on within our own context and our own families. In that, we show great affection and great respect for those gone before us, because we recognise their contribution to us, and we celebrate their memory by imitating their example. For such powerful presence of the Lord an example in our own lives and through our own lives for each other and ourselves, we pray today. To offer our prayers of intercession, I invite you please to stand. Each of our prayers ends with the invocation, Lord, in your mercy, to which I invite you to respond. Hear our prayer. For Ruby, in baptism she was given the pledge of life eternal. May she now be admitted to the company of the saints. Lord, in your mercy,
Amen.
For our sister who received the body of Christ, the bread of life, that she may be raised up on the last day. Lord, in your mercy,
Amen.
Hear our prayer. For all our deceased relatives and friends, for those who have helped us, supported us, encouraged us, and loved us, may they have the reward of their goodness. Lord, in your mercy,
Amen.
Hear our prayer. For all of those fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, they may see God face to face. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. And for the family and friends of Ruby, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. And for all of us assembled here to pray in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. Lord God, you are our shelter and our strength. You listen in love to the prayers of your people. So hear us as we pray for Ruby. Cleanse her and all the faithful departed of sin. Grant them the fullness of redemption. Our prayer we make through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Can I invite you to have a seat, please? And we'll continue our celebration of Mass, preparing the altar with the gifts of bread and wine that we use for our celebration of the Eucharist this morning. As we do so, can I invite you to join in singing our hymn that's printed in the order of service. It's number 898 in the hymn 898.
Thank you.
Let's stand and pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at our hands and the praise and glory of his name for our good and the good of all this holy church.
We present to you these offerings, Lord, for the salvation of your servant Ruby, and ask your mercy that she who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Saviour may know in him also a merciful Judge. Our prayer we make through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It
is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ Jesus our Lord. For in him the hope of resurrection has dawned, so that those saddened by the certainty of death might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful people, Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for us in the heavens. And so, with the angels, with the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as together with all the saints, without end, we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them, like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life, the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, John our Bishop, and all who minister in your church. Remember also our brothers and sisters fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. Remember your servant Ruby, whom you've called from this world to yourself. Grant that she who was united with your son in a death like his in baptism may also be one with him in his resurrection. Have mercy on us all, we pray, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, St. Joseph, our spouse, the apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to life eternal, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Can I invite you please to stand? And together we'll pray to God our Father in the words the Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope, the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will. You who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Let's offer each other a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Let's stand to pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in this sacrament of his body and blood food for our journey, mercifully grant that, having been strengthened by it, our sister Ruby may come to the eternal table of Christ's children in heaven. For he lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
With faith in Christ Jesus, we will reverently bury the body of Ruby, our sister. Let's pray then with confidence to God, in whose sight all creation lives, that he will raise up in holiness and power the mortal body of our sister and command her soul to be numbered among the blessed. May God grant her a merciful judgment, deliverance from death, and pardon of sin. May Christ the Good Shepherd carry her home to be at peace with the Father. May she rejoice forever in the presence of the Eternal King and in the company of the saints. I now end our Mass as I began it, sprinkling Ruby's remains with the waters of the baptismal font in which she first shared in the death and resurrection of Christ. And I'll use also incense as a reminder of the dignity our bodies have as temples of God's Holy Spirit, and symbolic also of our prayers rising in the presence of God. And as I do so, we sing together our anthem of final commendation. Hands, Father of Mercies, we commend our sister Ruby in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with them on the last day. We give you thanks for the many blessings you bestowed upon her in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of her fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us, listen to our prayers, and open the gates of paradise to your servant. Help us to remain to comfort one another with the assurances of our faith, until we all meet in Christ and are with you and our sister forever. Our prayer we make through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
In peace, Let us take Ruby to her place of rest.
Guide me.